Good morning. It's lovely to have you with us all. Thank you so much for joining us. It's Monday again, so we are back cooking live from Italy with Livia. And as requested, our recipe today is going to be the classic Bolognese ragu, so stay tuned. And obviously it's Monday as well, so because it's Monday, we've got our cookbook competition, our giveaway. And our giveaway today is a really lovely vegetarian cookbook. Seasonal recipes, very simple. So if you'd like to win the cookbook, then just pop in the comments, cookbook, and we'll draw a winner at the end of the cooking lesson. So let's see where Livia is. Hopefully she's ready. Hello.
Hello. Very well. I'm here in very sunny Faenza.
It's really nice. Spring has sprung, which is perfect. How was your weekend?
Weekend was very exciting. We had quite a few exciting lessons with a lot of people. So also new person that I'd never met before, and making it very exciting. Yesterday there were quite a lot of couples, I would say. You know, like there were at least three couples cooking together at the Sunday lunch that we have prepared together. But also three person by themselves. But we have enjoyed it.
Oh, great. It was fun. And you had your new aperitivo class on Saturday.
Yes, the aperitivo went very well. And I think the idea is that we will change the recipe quite often, let's say maybe every 15 days or 3 weeks, we should have new recipe. That's why we're going to do new recipes for the vegetarian and the Sunday lunch from starting this Sunday.
Perfect. And then I think we're waiting for your Easter recipes as well.
I know. This I'm taking quite a bit of time to do it. It's because here it was San Valentine, like there. So you have to think about what you cook for San Valentino. And then we have Carnival, which is, really taking all the space, you know, with the recipe, the fried recipe that was there. And then I see Easter very far away, but actually it's around the corner.
Yeah, it is. So, Livia, you're cooking, as I say, requested last week, Bolognese ragu, and I can see we've got some comments. So do you want to maybe just tell us about your recipe for today? And I'll just let you know, we've got some people just saying hello and catching up.
Okay. Sure. So ragu sauce can be made in many different ways. So when we talk about these important recipes, I would like everyone to know that, you know, everyone makes it slightly different depending on where you live and your traditional, and also how your family would have cooked it. You know, so the way I cook it is the way I've learned it from my family. So let's say my grandmother or the lady that used to cook for us at home. And it's very simple. It doesn't include certain ingredients that British always think we use, like garlic or rosemary, things like that. But still have a base of a sofrito, which everyone knows that I've already diced, you know, just to get ready, which is celery, carrot, and onion. As you can see, diced quite small, but they don't have to be really diced very small. There's people that leave it quite thick, and they like to see chunks of the vegetable in the sauce after it's been cooking for a long time. Instead, I dice it quite small, but I don't like to blend it. I don't like to have just a paste of vegetables together. I like to dice it quite small with a knife. Okay, and then the Bolognese sauce, and we will talk about the origins of it, comes from Bologna area. So Bologna is a region, an area where we use a lot of pork meat. And this is why ragu sauce has to be made with pork meat, okay? And a fat pork meat that we release the fat. Mm-hmm. Okay, so we got the meat that we are going to use. It's first pancetta, which is a minced pancetta, okay, that you can find easily here in this area because we all use it to make ragu sauce. Then this is minced pork meat. Slightly different from sausage. You could also substitute it with sausage pork meat. And this is beef, good quality of beef meat that you can see is quite red in color.
Yeah. And if anyone's looking for the recipe, Kieran's manning Facebook, say hi to Kieran, and he's popped the recipe in the comments below, so you can follow Livia's recipe as well. So you've got no excuses not to cook it for supper tonight.
Okay. So as you can see from the picture, we already have some ragu ready because ragu, what is typical from ragu is the fact that it has to cook for a long time. and it needs to cook. I think at my home, the way we make it is for at least 3 hours. I will say that sometimes I leave it even longer. I start it in, let's say, in the afternoon, and I finish cooking it the next morning, leaving it on the hob because it's still warm, obviously, and doesn't have any problem. So I like to cook it really for a long time, and I think when you cook it for a long time, the flavors change much. The idea is that the tomato have to cook well, you know, and doesn't have to have a lot of acidity. It is important that it simmer low flame, and that's why the best way to cook it, I think, is in a terracotta pot, like the one that you can see over there in the images. That way, the in a terracotta pot, the temperature is kept, you know, for longer. It takes a while to warm up, but then when it's warm, it keeps the temperature better, you know. So that's the best way to cook it. Okay. Then there are two other ingredients which are different from usual, you know, that you might think, I'm not sure you use them. It's for sure milk, right? Which, you know, everyone discuss about this, but in a lot of recipes there is milk, and also in the one that is registered in the office of Bologna, okay? And also red wine. Okay, I like to use red wine. You could have used white. I think red gives quite a lot of darker color, and that's why I like to use red instead of white.
Perfect. And then the milk, Livia, tell me, why do you add milk? It just seems counterintuitive to add milk into a meat sauce.
I know, that's quite strange. Actually, I've learned this from the grandmother of my boyfriend, the only boyfriend I had in my life for many years. And I remember, and she was from Bologna, so she was living in Bologna. And I remember for first time I saw it, I thought it was strange because my mother doesn't use milk in a ragu. But when you are from Bologna, most of the time you use it. Milk make the ragu creamy and soften the meat a lot, and also take off the acidity of the tomato. Okay. Talking about tomato, the kind of tomato that we're going to use is... mainly it's tomato paste, okay, since I'm not from Sicily, or I don't live in a country where they produce their own tomato paste, because it's not as sunny as it would be in the south of Italy, I buy it, okay, so this is actually made, Mutti is from Parma, okay, so tomato paste, actually this is triplo concentrato, so it's three times concentrate, okay, so it's very thick,
I love the
and also some tomato passata.
Yeah, the packaging is so
yeah.
Nice.
Yeah, Mutti got really nice packages, like the old way. Okay, so you could make it even just with tomato paste, but when you dilute it a little bit, you can add a bit of passata. Okay, but for sure, I don't use just passata, because ragu has to be thick. You have to be colored, very colored, and the meat has to be colored. And it could be even served on itself on a slice of bread. And here we go back to the origins of the name, okay? Because, you know, I'm telling you everything now, and then I will start working, otherwise we never finish. But but I just would like it to be clear. So that's why I say now, because I forget. So ragu is a name that go back to the origins, which are maybe French. So raguter, okay, was a verb. I don't know much French, but it means... awaken appetite. So it's something that used to be as a side to a main course to make your appetite higher. Okay. So that's maybe where the word ragu starts from. The original ragu that we talk about goes back to the 1890s, let's say maybe even earlier, but it was white without tomato. And that's the first ragu that Artusi, which is a food critic, let's say one of the first food critics that we have here in Italy, described this recipe as a white ragu with the meat that I've just told you and the vegetables that I told you, so celery, carrot, and onion, but is a white version without tomato. Just 20 years after, they have slightly changed the recipe and added the tomato. And also, instead of using macaroni, like he described the kind of pasta that he liked to use as an accomplishment with the sauce, he also divided, it was changed into tagliatelle. And this is why today I've made Wow. I've rolled a little bit of pasta, which is dry now. Actually, here it's quite warm because I got the hob on. It's quite dry, as you can see, but I'm going to slice it into tagliatelle shapes just to show you the final dish. Anyway, I got ragu ready already, but I will show you how to make it. I will tell you also the time that are needed to make the proper ragu between the adding of the extra ingredients, okay? But anyway, I got it already also done, so I will show you the proper color and the proper consistency. Okay, I said too many things at a time, but but I'm going to start now, Lorna. So I'm going on the hop.
That was really good, really useful explanation. As always, we've got some questions and some thoughts. Janet was saying she sometimes adds in chunks of chocolate to make it creamy as well, rather than milk. That's interesting.
What did you say? Chocolate?
Chocolate.
I never heard it. You see, but everyone have his own recipe, you know, like we do traditional recipes. So I think to learn a traditional recipe, you should go where in the place where it comes from and then learn it there. And then you can change it the way you like. But the traditional recipes are the way they are in the place where they come from. So it cannot be changed.
I remember we were just chatting earlier. I remember being with you in Bologna years ago, and we were chatting to one of the cooks, and we were talking about Bolognese sauce, and I must have asked a question, and she basically said to me, "Oh, what do you know about, you know, making Bolognese sauce?" And I was like, "I'll give up."
I remember it was Piera.
I remember. I was put back in my place. Obviously, don't know very much. And Val was just saying as well, actually, the color actually of your pasta, Livia, you know, it's just such a lovely color. So sort of.
Yeah, that's always very exciting because I like to use these red yolk eggs, which are chicken that are corn fed. Sorry, I had the flame quite high. So to make this ragu a little bit faster, I'm not using a terracotta one because it would take quite a long time to cook, you know, to warm up, even just the pan. So that's why I'm making it in a stainless steel one and not in a terracotta. Okay.
And obviously you're making today, Olivia, that's what you call the classic sofrito.
Exactly. Yeah. Sorry, I didn't describe it well. But yes, this is sofrito. Okay. It can be called, let's say, this is really called sofrito, the one for ragù, but it can be called also battuto in certain other areas. It's because it's beaten, it's diced very small, or otherwise because it's fried slowly all together. So that's why it's called sofrito. I have some olive oil. Okay.
Yeah, I remember years ago having a cook, and she actually, as you say, she did the sofrito, but then she put in lard and she mixed it all together in a battuto rather than a sofrito.
As I was saying, in every region is slightly different. So I'm telling you what, you know, comes from my area, but yeah, it got different names from wherever you move. Now, this recipe could be boring because it takes quite a long time to, it should take quite a while between going from one stage to the other. That's why sometimes when I'm an hostess in other regions with flavors and I see other cooks that make ragu, I'm always shocked because they don't stick to the rules, which I think are very important. And sometimes I'm shocked. You know, sometimes ragu sauce cannot be made in 15 minutes, for sure. It's something that takes its time. It's something you should do, for example, on Sunday, and then you can have the ragu all week long, for example. And my mother, for example, is very happy that we're doing this lesson today because she eats ragu every day. She would like to have ragu sauce every day. So it's a very local recipe.
Yeah, but presumably, as Olivia, it's really great because you can freeze it. So, you know, you can sort of pop it in.
You can freeze it. Even just keeping it in a jar, closed in the fridge, filled up, it would make it last for a long time. So usually I make a jar. I don't make just a little amount because it takes such a long time, consuming also gas to cook it, that when you make it, it's worth it to make a big amount. Then you can freeze it, sure, also in jars, but you can also just keep it for a week. And since we use it every day, because you know we eat pasta. Let's say my mother, if she doesn't have pasta at lunch, she doesn't feel like she's been eating. So She always say, if there's no pasta, you know that I feel strange when I have lunch without pasta. So that's why, and ragu, also ragu can be transformed after you've made the base with the meat and the vegetables. Ragu can be changed slightly, adding, for example, when you warm it to add it to the pasta, you can add peas, for example, or you can add mushrooms to it, or, for example, you can add cream to it and make what we call pasticciato, so ragu with cream makes pasticciato. And so there are many different ways to kind of transform it, but the base is always what you are watching now. So you should...
Sorry, yes, anyone who's watching, I think they've got the message that in Italy, you know, it's very traditional and you stick to the rule of what you have to eat there.
And also you have to stick to the rules of the person that is cooking for you.
Completely.
So now, because I want to go a little bit faster, I'm going to start to add the meat, but you should at least soften the vegetables until they are quite soft. So let's say about 15, 20 minutes. So they have to start changing the color. You have to see the transparency through the onion. And when that is happening, then you can add the first meat. And for me, the first meat is pancetta, which is more fat. And I want the fat of the pancetta to be released into the soffritto.
Yeah, this is flavor, which is great. And so last week we did pesto. I wonder if anyone made pesto last week after your amazing demonstration. Maybe we'll get a few messages and let us know. And yeah, don't forget, we've got a cookbook. If anyone would like a vegetarian cookbook, do just pop your name, just pop cookbook in the comments below. It's got some lovely recipes and a really nice recipe for rhubarb and ginger upside down cake, which sounded really delicious. Yeah, nice vegetarian cookbook.
Is it a book of a British author?
He's a British cook. It came out last year, actually, and it's seasonal vegetables, and he has it sort of broken down into autumn, spring, summer, winter, and just ideas of vegetables and what's in season and what you could cook. So I think everybody's looking for new ideas just now. I think we're all having to, you know, get ideas for recipes and things because we're cooking at home so much. It's quite nice to get some more inspiration. I know I am.
Definitely. You're right, yeah.
And everyone always says the whole debate, Livia, about bolognese sauce and how you never ever serve it with spaghetti. Tell me about that one.
Yeah. So bolognese sauce, originally, as we were saying, Artusi, which is this food person that described the recipe for the first time in 1891, wrote this book, which is La scienza in cucina e l'arte di mangiare. He was not really a writer. He was a critic of art. I mean, he was not a chef, I want to say. He was just a writer, and he was a critic of art in general, even literature. And he wrote the first cooking book that we got in Italy. It's not Bottura, but it's Artusi. Bottura did the prefazione. Okay, so he described the recipe, and he's using macaroni with it. Okay, and as I was saying, 20 years after, in Bologna, they decided that macaroni were not right, and you should have used tagliatelle, which is what I'm going to show you in a few minutes. So it's not spaghetti, it's just that when the Italians went to live abroad and they went to United States, I have to check the ragu, because otherwise I'm going to burn it. They were cooking ragu sauce with the kind of pasta that they could find easily, and they were bringing easily in United States dry pasta, packages of pasta. So that's why they used to use it with spaghetti, maybe. So that's why they think that spaghetti should be what you eat ragu sauce with, but actually tagliatelle is the right shape for the ragu sauce. So now that, as you can see, it's becoming more greasy because the fat has been released in the pan, the fat of the pancetta. I'm going to add also the pork minced. Okay, and then when I don't like to add too many at the time because I will cool down the temperature too much, and then the grease is not released in the fat is not released in the same way when the temperature is cold. So I'm adding it little by little. So as soon as I've sealed and cooked a little bit this pork minced meat, I'm going to add the beef.
Okay. Mm-hmm. It looks delicious. And obviously on the right hand side, you can see one that's already cooking away. It looks lovely too.
Yes, it's concentrating the liquid. And I've started making it this morning at 9. So I didn't even cook for very long time. It's quite just for, 3 hours, let's say. I'm adding a little bit of water. You should always have some, instead of water, you should have some stock, some broth, you know, to add it to the, to give it more flavor and dilute the tomato that, as we were saying, is usually tomato paste. So it needs to be diluted with liquid.
Okay. And the ideal cooking time for a ragu then, Livia, sort of 2 or 3 hours over a low heat?
Yeah, I think 3 hours should be right. You know, let's say minimum. I think it will be less. Because it really changes the flavor the longer it cooks. So, and then when you serve it, I've worked for many years in a restaurant where the owner was an old person, and he used to say that you should serve the ragu on top of the pasta without mixing it in a pan. Okay, so ragu should be served on top. That's how it would be nice. And then when you eat it, you mix it yourself with a fork, I will show you. So it needs to be quite thick. That's why it doesn't have to be a liquid, very tomato sauce, you know, very liquid. That's why we don't use passata, but we use concentrato, okay? And that's because the meat should be quite dense.
And you would add fresh tomatoes now.
No, fresh tomatoes don't give color at all. And we need something concentrate here. It's quite a lot of meat, so I know for British it's shocking, but this is the salt that we to use. Now, when I say it, really, I remember I can hear every time we add any salt to any course that we prepare, usually I can hear, I can hear this sound, you know, around us. But really, we actually here we're cooking with a big amount of meat. It's about 200 grams of each minced that we are adding, and one carrot, one onion, and two celery sticks. So it's quite a lot of ingredients that we need to be flavored.
And the sauce, then, what, that would feed 6 people or 8 people, or what sort of proportion-wise?
I think I will be able to make 2 jars out of these. So yes, for sure, even 10 person, yeah. Okay, consider that now I'm making everything quite fast. Okay, for you not to have to wait too long, but you should make sure that the meat is all well sealed before adding any other ingredients. So now I don't see any red color. So I can start adding first the wine, and I like to use red, as I was saying, because it gives more color, it helps the tomato to be brighter. I'm not maybe going to use all of this glass. Maybe a little bit more than half should be enough for this amount. I'm also using quite a narrow pan. You see, not too big. I think the perfect one would be the one you see back here, which is the terracotta pan.
And do you add the milk next then? Or is it the
first? I like to add the wine.
Okay.
Okay, and then I'm going to add it now so that the alcohol will evaporate. So usually the flame should be quite high so that the alcohol evaporates faster, otherwise it leaves too much acidity. And then you should wait for the alcohol to leave even 10 minutes. Now I'm not, but yeah, I'm going to wait a few minutes, and I'm going to add, not 10 minutes, and I'm going to add the milk that will make it very creamy. Just 2 minutes until, when you don't smell the alcohol anymore, and I can tell you that the alcohol is one of the first things that evaporate, also in my kitchen, it goes away very fast. So it takes very short. Do you make ragu? I know, I remember you make ragu.
Yes, we do. It's one of our standard weekly dishes, definitely. But I was just thinking, actually, I always mix the pasta with the sauce before I serve it. So actually, that was a good top tip. That's really useful.
It's a different concept. It's the idea, as we were saying, the origin of ragu, it comes from the French, and it was a side dish to another course. And it was not pasta in France, but it became pasta in Italy when they imported this recipe, let's say, and start to talk about that in books. So that's why it was a side dish, let's say, because it was a meat course on itself. So that's why we also got other sauces, ragu sauces, famous in Italy, and the most famous one is the Napolitan ragu, which take even more than a day to make it, and it's slightly different. So I'm going to add now the milk. Okay, you will see it makes a big difference into the consistency of the mixture that we are cooking. It will make it creamy. As you can see, the color is changing already. Mm. And you can see, as you can see, it looks creamy already.
Yeah, that's amazing.
And now, after you add the milk, they obviously have cooled down the temperature, you should cover it and let it cook for even half an hour or even longer. To slow down the flame, cover it, and wait until the colors change. It's not white anymore. And the sauce looks very creamy already. This is a way to soften the meat and make it ragu creamy, and also to take acidity off the tomato later.
And just a couple of questions, actually. Val was just saying, would that be whole milk you used? It's not like semi-skimmed milk or...
I've used oat milk. That's mainly because, you know, in Italy, we don't have a good quality of milk, so we never think about that. I think today I've used whole milk, but I don't think it makes a big difference. I think you should maybe use the skimmed milk or semi-skimmed, because we don't want extra fat in the milk. We want it creamy, but we don't want it too heavy. You could not use cream, you know, so your milk is quite strong and very powerful. I don't know, it's quite heavy when it's good, and you know, so I think maybe skimmed or semi-skimmed should be right better. Okay. So now, we wait a few minutes, and then I'm adding the tomato, and then it's, let's say, finished. I think because I have it already prepared. It was just to show you the process and the order of the ingredients as they are.
Mm. Yeah, that's great. That's really interesting, Livia.
Very good. And I'm going to add I'm going to slice first the tagliatelle now that we're here. Before the sun, I feel as sunny as I cannot see you.
I know.
So I will slice my tagliatelle, which I've left a little bit thicker than usual because I was drying the dough. Okay, but a little bit. Okay, so I will slice it now to make tagliatelle. Is it too bright? Because now we don't like it.
Fine. No, it's perfect.
Okay. So I'm going to fold it on itself. One side and the other side. You see, my kitchen is quite warm, so the pasta dried very fast. So I fold it on itself. Okay, I will cut it here in the middle. Okay, and I will slice 7 millimeters width of tagliatelle. Narrow.
Yeah, so another quick question. So Julia was just asking, so, you know, last week we did the pesto, you used dried pasta with the pesto, and yet this week with the ragu, we're going to use fresh pasta. So how do you decide whether you use fresh pasta or dried pasta with different sauces?
Allora, it was just because I'm not from Liguria, and I'm not really able to make trofie by hand. I could have made a trofie by hand if I was very able to show you, but since I don't want to show you something, I'm not very good into making it. You could have it was the trofie that I bought, actually they were fresh, they were not dried. They were the one that you keep in the fridge. So even if it's water and flour pasta, it can be fresh, doesn't mean it's dry.
And do you ever use dry pasta, Livia?
Do I have? Yes, there are all the pasta that I love, like spaghetti, quindi, I don't know, bucatini or spaghetti or mezze maniche alla carbonara. I don't do those recipes. Those sauces that we have just used to show you how to make the sauce are good with dry pasta, not with fresh pasta. Okay. But ragu sauce and tagliatelle should be made, you know, fresh, you know, like, and because it's egg pasta, so the quality is different. So if you look at my pasta, and now maybe
it looks
the sun,
so perfect. It looks so perfect.
It's quite, as you can see, it's quite rough. The surface is rough, and the surface of the pasta is rough when you roll it with a rolling pin, and when you roll it on a wood surface. So a wooden rolling pin and a wooden surface give let's say a rough surface where the sauce will stick better. It's very sunny. I don't know. The sun is coming here right now.
Is it quite spring-like in Italy?
Yeah, before 2 days ago, it was very warm, like spring, and all of a sudden we had a day of the snow. Now the temperature is down. There's still a little bit of snow. We have a day of snow, just one, but now it seems very warm. Especially here, in my kitchen is very warm.
Okay, it was great. It looks
so if you could touch the consistency with a spoon of the meat, you will see it's already creamy. Even if we are cooking it fast, not really in the right way, it should slowly cover and simmer for longer with milk. It's already very creamy, and the consistency of the meat have changed a lot. And touching it, it's very, very softer than a few minutes ago. But now I'm going to add the tomato so that you can see the old recipe. So we start with tomato paste. Okay. I think in Sicily, usually they don't buy the tube like I'm using here, but they buy it at the market by the weight. Okay. Instead, here, since I was saying it's not local, use a tube. So if you use a tomato paste that maybe you bought when you were away with flavors in Sicily, and maybe you are keeping it in the freezer, you should dilute it with a little bit of water, because tomato paste from Sicily is very thick and very concentrated. So it needs to be diluted before use, or you should add some water as soon as you add the paste. You see, this tube is thick, but not as much as the Sicilian one. Okay, so I'm just mixing in. It seems like it's not enough, and it seems like it's not giving a lot of color. That's because it takes a while to give the color, and it needs to be diluted with liquid. Okay. But the color has already changed. So I'm adding also a little bit of passata, but really, really little amount, let's say half a glass, just to use it as a liquid to dilute the paste.
You always have those lovely expressions in Italy, like, you know, a little bit, you know, a guccio, like a mouthful. You've always got nice expressions when you're cooking.
Difficult to translate them sometimes. I don't know. Okay, so and now I'm going to add some water. I'm going to use the water to dilute the paste, as we were saying, and to make it cook slowly covered for 3 hours, I'm going to add always, little by little, some extra water that should be stocked to give it even more flavor. In this case, I'm going to use the water which is here, ready to boil the pasta. Okay, so I'm adding a little bit just to show you how it should always be simmering, covered with a lid, slowly. Okay. Low flame, I don't know. Because we will say piano piano, like you were saying, so I don't know how to translate it.
Slowly.
Okay. So we have added already salt. I will add extra salt to flavor the tomato and the liquid that I've been using. At the end, I will check and add some salt if it's needed, and pepper just at the end, because I don't like... I'm worried that the tomato will concentrate and then the saltiness will become exaggerated, you know, like if you add too much salt now. So it's better to check the flavor almost at the end and add some salt at the end if it's needed, for sure. And also pepper.
Yeah, and you did add in a little bit of salt anyway.
Yes, but I add the salt to the meat. So every ingredient that we add, I like to flavor it. Mm-hmm. So you always should add salt and the flavors that are needed to each ingredient you add in a recipe that have different stages.
That's perfect.
Right. Don't do just at the end. Every ingredient should be flavored at the time when you add it. Okay, now I move here towards the tagliatelle, okay, which are going to be cooked. So we need salt for the pasta, the water of the pasta, usually rock salt, okay? And then we are ready, if you want.
And don't use any olive oil when you're in the water for the pasta?
No, that's usually, when you make lasagna sheets, which are very thin and they cook all together, and they are a shape that can get all in one block, you could add a little bit of olive oil, but with this fresh pasta, it would never stick. Also, it is instead very important that the pasta dries a little bit before slicing it and before cooking it. The consistency of the pasta that you cook would be much better if you dry the pasta before boiling it. So it should be always a little bit dry.
And could you maybe, at that stage, Livia, could you freeze the pasta to use it later?
Yes, that's exactly what you should do. And that's why when you make pasta, also that's what we do at the lessons when we do the Sunday lesson. I like to do amounts that allow you to have pasta enough for a week, let's say, you know, like, or for even more that you can keep in the fridge. Because when you make pasta, it's a little bit of an effort, right? So you don't want to, you have to take out the board, roll it like if you're going to the gym. So once you make it, you should make enough to be able to use it in the next day. Every time we have fresh pasta, is not fresh, that means just made. It's fresh because it's not dried, but it's frozen. So in every restaurant, we cook pasta from fresh, but frozen. You know, like you have a freezer behind you, a boiler, and you boil the pasta there. Even grannies have giant freezers in their kitchen because they freeze all the pasta for it to last longer. Okay, so I'm going to cook one, just don't have much water boiling, and I will keep this for the next days.
Great. Gosh, I always, Livia, when we do these classes at lunchtime, I always end up feeling like really hungry, and I've got salad today for lunch because it's Monday. I'm trying to be healthy, and I look at that lovely pasta and wish I was neater.
Yeah, but I think pasta is, you know, it doesn't let you feel the need of eating anything else. So I think it's healthy at the end because you just eat these, you have a meat and pasta and carbohydrate in the same dish, and it's healthy. I never thought I don't eat healthy because I eat pasta. I think both. I don't know, maybe it's not different. But comunque I'm glad I'm making you hungry.
Yeah, well, a couple of comments. I was saying she's having a bacon butty. So yes. Yeah, it's lovely actually. So we've Val's been with us, James here as well. We've got Anne, we've got Sharon, we've got Nanette. We've got our usual lunchtime cooking crew as well, which is really nice. We've got Liz. It's nice, really nice.
And a lot of them are looking for the vegetarian book.
Yeah, that's right. And I think Kieran's going to pick the winner. He'll do the automatic number thing. So yeah, anybody else, last chance to get the vegetarian cookbook, just pop your name down and Kieran will let us know who's won, which is great. We're nearly at the end, Livia.
I know, yes, it's ready. I'm just going to drain it now. You see, it just takes really a few minutes when it's fresh pasta.
Yeah.
So I'm going to drain it over here.
Perfect. And I wonder if anyone's, so last week we asked everyone what they wanted to cook for this week, and we got the ragu sauce. If there's anything else you'd like Livia to cook for next week, then please let us know and we can get that.
Yeah, I was thinking it would be nice to do something with fish, and I was thinking I would like to show you a typical kind of fish just prepared in Sardinia, okay, which is called fregola with a fish sauce, since we didn't do anything with fish since a while. So
gosh, that looks lovely. Yeah. And just the plate, such lovely plates as well.
Yeah, there's always Apulian, for la Puglia. I come over there so I can show you better, maybe.
Ecco qua. Yeah, I know, it's delicious. Pasta and sunshine. And no parmesan yet?
Sure, yes. a lot of Parmigiano, as always. Yeah. A lot of Parmigiano, that it goes very well. So you would mix it with your fork now, and that's the best way to serve it. Also.
And made pasta is usually very delicate, so it cannot be
stirred or sauteed much in the, you know, in the pan.
I think we've got a few votes for fish, so it looks like we're going to do fish next week. And the winner of the cookbook is Julia. Excellent. Get the cookbook off to you, Julia, as well.
Okay.
Super. Perfect. Thank you so much, Livia. That was delicious.
Thank you.
Great.
Thank you very much.
We'll catch up next week. Okay, take care. Bye-bye now.
Bye. Bye-bye.